I'm going to read the scripture to you, or just a piece of it. It said 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9 through 10. And I'm just going to read chapter 2, yeah, just verse 9 through 10. And then I want you to marinate on this as you worship. Tonight I'm going to be teaching you about how to embrace the Spirit-filled life. And some of us, we're so disconnected from the Holy Spirit, it would feel unfamiliar if he spoke to you. We've been so dry that a little drop of water would almost hurt. But God wants to answer somebody's prayers and fill somebody up. Let me just speak this one truth to you. The Bible says that those who repent may times of refreshing come to you. Don't pray for God to bless you. Pray, God, may I repent tonight of who I've been and what I've done. Let me read this scripture to you. It says, but as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. Now, this is the rejoicing scripture. So we don't get to hear it if you're clogged up. He said, you can't hear it, you can't see it, you won't feel it if you're clogged up. Somebody begin to pray, Lord, unclog me. He says, but God has revealed them, God has revealed the mysteries that no one else can hear to them through his Spirit. For the Spirit searches all things. Yes, the deep things of God. Lord, in Jesus' name, as we get ready to worship, search the deep things in our life. Lord, I pray if our eyes are blind, open our eyes. I pray if our ears are clogged, unclog our ears. I pray if our heart is stiffened and frozen and seared to the conscience of God. I pray, Lord, that you would mend the brokenhearted, open the hardened hearted right now. And Lord, that you might reveal the mysteries of God to us as we worship. In Jesus' name, let's worship, Bridge. Thank you, Jesus. come with anybody, grab a hold of your hand, and then I want you to begin to pray in the Holy Spirit right now. We're not here to just go through the motions. We need to pray together, worship together. And I want you to begin to speak. If you came with somebody you love, go ahead and pray for them. You need to pray for them. We should be praying for them. If you're online and you're at home and you got some family members, some friends you need to pray for, go ahead, grab their hand in the name of the Spirit and begin to speak life into them. Begin to pray for them, because when the worship proceeds and the prayer proceeds, the prophetic can follow. And if we want to see God, if we want to hear from God tonight, if we want to see a new thing tonight, if we want to feel a new word come into our life tonight, it needs to start with worship and with prayer. And Lord, I thank you, God, that we're not foolish and we're not ignorant to know, God, Lord, that the things of the Spirit are voice activated and we need to speak them into existence. No, don't complain to God. Begin to speak life with God. Begin to declare some things. Begin to speak hope. Begin to speak plans in a future over your life, over your friends, over your family, over your loved ones, over your future. Lord, in Jesus' name, we thank you, God, that we take hold, God, Lord, of supernatural things, God, Lord, that we cannot see and we cannot physically wrestle, but God, we bombard heaven in the supernatural, putting tens of thousands to flight, because our weapons are truly not carnal, but they are powerful for the pulling down of strongholds and the casting down of imaginations. And Lord, I thank you, God, Lord, that we can now speak with your word and not with our imagination. I can't trust what I think, but I can trust what you've spoken. And Lord, let us continue to be a conduit, God, Lord, of your word and your will and your way. Holy Spirit, move in this place and in this house. Move in every home and every heart and every life and every soul, and unlock some things tonight. Before you're seated, I'm going to give you a quick word of truth that will help begin what I want to share tonight. Your life is a sum total of the voices you've allowed. Your life is a sum total of the voices you have allowed in you. And what we're going to do tonight is we're going to let some voices go. And we're going to let the voice speak. The Holy Spirit is going to speak tonight. And he's going to speak to you. And I don't know if you've ever been in a Spirit-filled service. We used to just call them forward, lay hands on them and say, "Be filled in the name of Jesus." And we would call down fire from heaven. And we still might do that tonight. But I'm telling you, what we're going to start with is unlocking some things. And one of them is shutting some voices down. I'm ready. Why don't you go ahead, give somebody a high five, tell them, get ready. Tonight's going to be great. And you may be seated. Okay, I need you to work quickly with me. I don't have a lot of time, and I want to get right back into it. Josh, make sure you're back up here around 45-ish, 47, okay? And I want to give you a lot of scriptures up front that are going to set the tone, and then I want to teach what the Holy Spirit has been speaking to me for quite some time. Number one, I want you to write down as you're taking notes, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 7, and I want you to write all the way through verse 16. That's where I read to you earlier. Then I also want you to write down Luke chapter 13, verse 18 through 21. Verse 18 through 21. I have a lot of scripture, as I mentioned. Then I want you to write down Acts chapter 4, verse 13. Acts chapter 4, verse 13. And I'm giving you a lot of scripture because I want you to have a lot of content, because Wednesday night's the core, and I know that. So if you're the core, and if you're leaders, and if you're incredible men and women of God who are either becoming a leader or already are a leader, I want to equip you for the good work of the Lord, okay? So Romans chapter 8, verse 25 through 30. Romans chapter 8, verse 25 through 30. Many are familiar with Romans chapter 8. And then I want you to also write down 2 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16 through 18. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16 through 18. And then the last one I want to give to you is I want to give you Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7 through 9. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7 through 9. Now, all these are wonderful, and all these are important, and all these are going to empower you and unlock some things in your life. But I want you to go with me to Romans chapter 8, verse 25. And I'm going to kind of jump off of and then juxtapose the two scriptures that I've mentioned first, which is from Corinthians, 1 Corinthians, and then also from Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, verse 25, and I'm going to read a few verses here, media team, just to give you a little bit of a heads up. But if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly wait for it with perseverance. Likewise, the Spirit, everybody say the Spirit, also helps in our weakness, which could easily be a wonderful passage for you right now. While you are trying to persevere with hope for what God is going to do for the things that are unseen, I want to talk about unseen things just for a little bit before we talk about unlocking things. What are some things that you do not see that you wish to see? What are some things in your own life, in a family member's life? What are some things in your finances? Somebody said amen right there. What are some things in your life that you want to see but now are unseen? And when they are unseen, it's very difficult to carry hope, but thanks be to the Holy Spirit who will give you strength in your weakness. When you want to give up on your dream, when you want to give up on your hope, that's when he says, don't give up just yet. When you want to give up on the reason you are alive today is even though you may have given up on your purpose, you're still breathing because the Spirit of God within you has not given up on you yet. And there are some things that are unseen that need to be seen. Somebody say, I want to see. Somebody say it again, I want to see. I want to see this church, what it's going to look like 40 years from now. Amen. I want to see what our city looks like 40 years from now. I'm not in this for the short sprint. I'm in this for the long haul. And I'm here to see God fulfill every. It took me 13 years to pray a baby in. It took us a long time to believe that we could become senior pastors. If your dream has only been a year or two or 10, you haven't prayed long enough. Keep praying because God will fulfill every unseen desire and every unseen aspiration that comes from the throne room of heaven if you'll stick it through. And if you'll allow the Spirit, we want to talk about embracing the Spirit-filled life, but you got to start by saying, hey, there's some things that I have not seen that I wish to see. Somebody said amen right there. Because you believe that there's something better. Maybe you can be better. Maybe life could be better. Maybe our nation could be better. Maybe the world could be better. What are some of those unseens? Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weakness, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. I'm going to come back to that in a minute. Now, he who searches, what does it say? He who searches the heart. Listen to the flow of thought. All my English majors. He who knows the heart. Whose heart? Your heart. What the mind? He says, he who searches the heart knows what the mind of the Spirit is. So he goes from your heart to his mind. He goes from your heart to his mind. And he says, I search your heart because God knows we all know your mind is messed up, right? But I search your heart because I want to see the intent of a man. I want to see where it came from. I'm not interested in the fruit of your problem. I'm interested in the root of your problem. And he says, I want to search the root of your problem, because you may have a surface level problem, but you got a deep root issue. And I want to talk to the deep root issues. And I'm not just going to talk to you from your conscious level. I'm not going to talk to you from your logical level. I'm not even going to talk to you from a natural level. I'm going to talk to you from a supernatural level, because I don't want to know what your thoughts and your way. I want to put some of my mind in you. And so the Spirit searches all things. He searches our heart. And he says, now I know because I have the mind to put in you. He says, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together. This is where that scripture comes in. How many know this? We know that all things work together for the good of those who love him. And we like to quote that scripture, but we'd fail to notice that we have to let God search our heart and change our mind first. And God wants to work all things for your good, but he hasn't. Who am I preaching to right now? Am I preaching to anybody who's like, you're like, wait a second. Well, I've been praying and I go to church and I do this and I do that and I believe God. And God's saying, you haven't let me search your whole heart and you haven't let me change your mind. So I can't work all things for the good of those who love me, even though you love me. My hands are tied. Oh, I'm gonna unlock it tonight. You're gonna unlock something because you have failed to recognize that God wants to do something, but all scripture promises proceed with if you, then I. And if you understand that there's a greater promise for you that wants to work in you and through you by the power of the Holy Spirit, who is a who and not an it. And I believe that God wants to speak to somebody right now and change the picture of the God you never knew. Because a lot of us want the evidence of God's power in our life. But we don't want the power of his presence in our life. Because if I just have the evidence of God in my life, I might not have to surrender my heart to him. But if I have the power of his presence in my life, I'll have to change first. And there's a changing that must take place when you embrace the Spirit-filled life. Slap somebody and say, you better embrace it. You better embrace it, because this is your way of changing your future. Because if your life is a sum total of the voices you've been listening to, first of all, what do those voices sound like? Who are they? And if they're not God, where are they taking you? Is it somewhere you want to be? And if you keep listening to all those voices, how many are crazy like me? You got like 9 voices in your head, and every once in a while you think, I think I'm crazy. I don't think I'm all there. And you get, come on, anybody else like me, just normal human being, you have a 100 different voices. You're like, is that God? Is that my father? Is that my father-in-law? Who is speaking to me? Is that my wife? And Emily's like, I'm talking out loud. And you have all these things where you're like, hey, whoa, wait a minute. And you kind of feel like you're crazy, but God's saying, no, I need you to. See, the enemy of you embracing the Spirit-filled life, write this down. The number one enemy of you embracing the Spirit-filled life is busyness. And more than even busyness, because busyness can look different. I can be new doing nothing and be busy, because I don't let my mind rest and let the Holy Spirit speak. And I can be doing 100 different things just so I'm occupied, so I don't have to think about what I should be thinking about and dwell upon the voice that I should be hearing. But I want to hear everybody's voice. This is where we get in trouble, is because we want to associate ourselves to some business Well, I'm just listening to a good business podcast because, you know, we connect. Do they know the mysteries of who you are in your life that can reveal the truth of your life? What YouTube video out there? I'm hearing a lot of people who keep sending me these prophets of like the end times and bless Johnny Wonderful, but let me just tell you, stop listening to them. You need to study the art of shut up, and you need to shut some things up in your life, and you need to shut yourself up in your life a little bit, because you need to master the first battle. Because you remember, he talks about the heart and the mind, the heart and the mind, the heart and mind. How do you embrace the Spirit-filled life? How do you host the Holy Spirit in your life? Now, we'll get to the heart in a second, but let me talk about the mind, because it's the voices you hear that shape your thoughts. So you need to silence some thoughts, and you need to deal with your mind. Elijah did it like this. Elijah wanted to hear a miracle from God. So what did he do? He put his head between his knees. Right? Why? Does anybody know why he did that? Was it some weird, super spiritual thing that every time you bow and put your head between your knees, you're going to see rain and a miracle from God when you just... No! He was eliminating, because your mind, every by nature, people are manipulative. No one wants to say amen on that, because you have to admit you are. Everybody by human nature is manipulative. And if Elijah would have just been like, I'll go to the top of the mountain, Josh, I'll go. He'd have been like, I think I see something. We're good. It's coming. It'll be, and we're going to manipulate a situation, because we already know the outcome we desire. So I'm going to go ahead and begin to talk about it. And I'm going to act like I'm just speaking it into faith. But really, I'm just No. Shut your mouth. Put your head down deep somewhere where you can't hear anybody, see anybody. And when you finally get there, you'll shut your mind down long enough where you can hear God. You cannot embrace the Holy Spirit when you've embraced everybody else's voice that shapes you, molds you, takes you. The reason Jesus could walk, remember, what did he say all the time? I don't do anything unless the Father tells me. I don't say anything unless the Father tells me. Why? He spent so much time away from the disciples in prayer. He even shut the disciples up and said, I need to spend time alone with the Father. All the way to his death, when finally he was about to die, and the only reason he could die is because he surrendered his spirit and he stopped speaking the word of God. And that's when we hear, Eli, Eli, Allah Shabbakanai, because he was speaking, God, why have you forsaken me? Because all of a sudden now he embraced the fullness of the wickedness and the sin of man, and God's face had to turn and the spirit had to depart. And in that moment, that's when he was alone. But that's the only time he could die, is when he finally didn't embrace this, couldn't have the Spirit with him, because the Holy Spirit can't dwell with sin. And when he had that gone and we had the face of the Father, if you want the attention of God and you want the Spirit of God, you continue to speak the Word of God and you continue to embrace the Spirit of God and you begin to say it, because as long as Jesus was talking, he could not die. But he had to get to this place where we all have to understand, like, we got to get to the place where we just, number one, when we kind of hear, we think we know it's God, respond. The Bible says, the sheep shall know my voice. That's one of the scriptures I gave you in the Gospels. And they'll answer. They'll come. The reason why I can preach a series on culture and the Holy Spirit and I can preach on team mentality is because it resonates with this house. There's something that resonates in your heart. There's something that you didn't even like me, know me, or feel, but you heard something and there's a sound better than Landon that you hear and you're like, oh, something in me. I resonate with that, Pastor. This series, I'm hearing so many testimonies and reports about. Why? Because it's good for this house. And let me go a step further. If it's good for this house, it's good for your house. And I'm telling you this because the voice that is coming through Landon tonight is for you. And for not just for here, but for there. Where's there? Your home. Where's there? Your prayer closet that you should have made 10 years ago, right? I'm pointing, right? Where is there? Oh, that comfy spot in your house. Where is there? Right next to Chester at our house, right over there, right? My mother-in-law's in the back. She loves our little cat. And we're actually going to give her that cat because she loves it so much. But you have these spots where you're just, why aren't we creating a place in our home to say, this is where I apply the word that I have now heard? Because I apply every other voice. When fear speaks, I sure do respond to fear. When doubt speaks, oh man, I definitely jump to. When discouragement, I answer. Who is calling you? And some of you, let me give you another one. When it comes to the voice of God, not, this is like for a whole nother sermon and how to hear God. But you ever had times where felt like God called you to church? Or called you to read your Bible, or called you to do something, and then all of a sudden you felt like, where'd that go, that feeling, that direction? And it's like silence, and you feel like no one's talking anymore. You know what I've learned? It's easy as understanding your GPS. You ever turn on your GPS when you're trying to find somewhere? right? And then if you're on your GPS and you turn, and it's like you're only a couple, a little bit away from making a turn, they're like, hey, 500 feet, make a turn, 500 feet, make a turn. But if you got a long route ahead of you and it's like 20 miles before you need to make a turn, does GPS talk to you? So keep going straight. You don't need to make a turn. You need to keep doing what you always, I'm talking to, who am I preaching to tonight? The Holy Spirit gave you a word, and you need to activate the word by saying, I'll just keep moving, I'll just keep moving, I'll just keep praying, I'll keep praying, I'll keep studying, I'll keep reading. And the more you keep straight, everybody likes to talk about, well, I prayed a long time and I don't see anything happen. Keep praying. Keep praying. Oh, I've worshiped a lot and I've been to church a lot. So what? Who cares? Keep going. It's the quitter in you that wants to stop at the point where your doubt begins. But you have to be able to go into that holy scripture and say, even in my weakness, when I can't really see my destination ahead, I'm just going to trust the GPS. And I know I don't need to make a turn. I don't need to make a change. I'm going to keep going straight down. Oh, I gotta keep moving. But this is just the mind, because remember, there's two parts when it comes to embracing the Holy Spirit. Sometimes our mind will get in the way of you speaking in tongues and prophesying, because there's nine fruits of the Spirit, nine gifts of the Spirit. How many know them? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And those are fruits. Why? Fruit for who? Everybody else. So you need to ask other people, do you think I'm self-disciplined? No one said a word or moved a muscle. When was the last time you asked them? Because it's a fruit of the Spirit. So if you don't have a fruit, you don't have the fruit, because he is the fruit. So where's your self-discipline? Where's your kindness, goodness, patience, faithfulness, self-discipline? Where are all those things? And then there's the nine gifts of the Spirit, right? A word of knowledge, a word of wisdom, a prophetic word. Then there's also a faith, a building of faith. Then there's a gift of healings, gift of miracles. And then there's discernment, discerning of the spirits. Then there's speaking in tongues and interpreting tongues. There's nine gifts of the Spirit, nine fruits of the Spirit broken down into threes. Each one is a development of maturity. And I don't have time to go into teaching you, but you start at the basics and you work your all the way through to say, I want to let the Holy Spirit unlock some things in me, because if you deny a gift, you deny the gift. It's not about having whether or not I work in a gift. I work in the gift of the Holy Spirit. And as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance, they began to speak in tongues and prophesy. It's not according to what I will. It's according to gift. Him. His gift. And so I want you to begin to unlock some things. Because he says, I want to reveal some mysteries to you. Remember when I read that? He wants to reveal mysteries. Mysteries that no one else, no eye has seen. No ear has heard, nor has entered the heart of man. He said, but those mysteries are now revealed to us by the Spirit. So when you embrace the Spirit, he now searches your heart to reveal what? Everybody say it. Mysteries. This is the title of my message. I wanted to wait till here to give it to you. It's called Click. That's what I want to call it. Click. Because as a pastor, I look at you deep in your eyes and I walk around this sanctuary and I listen and I feel for that click. I'm preaching and I'm teaching or we're worshiping and all of a sudden I hear click, 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 click. Why? Because there are things inside of you that no one and nothing can unlock but the Holy Spirit. And in your heart, God searches the depths of who you are so that he can unlock the hidden gifts and talents and abilities. I think it's frustrating as hell when I hear everybody else talking about, I know you. Oh, I know you. I don't even know me. How do you know me? I'm still figuring. Come on. Who am I talking to? I'm still figuring me out. But some self-help guru, some prophet, some evangelist says, oh, I know you. What the hell? You don't know me. The Holy Spirit knows me. And he put giftings and talents and abilities in me. And when I let the Holy Spirit search me, it's not to judge me, but it's to come into my life and click, click, Landon, keep going, keep unlocking, keep unlocking, keep unlocking. There's something great in you that if you let the Holy Spirit pass your logic and into your heart, he'll unlock something. I brought this up because my wife has lots of wonderful decorative pieces. And this is just decoration. But I almost wish I had like a locksmith up here making a key. And the reason why is because I have all these keys up here, but they're all different shapes and sizes. And they're glued together to make a ball, I guess. Welded. There we go. Welded, smoldered, what? Soldered. Okay, yeah, sure. Okay. Like that's a word. Just kidding. So, you see all these keys, and they're all different shapes. You ever had a key? I love it because it's the shape of a globe. Makes me think of the earth. Makes me think of people. You ever had a key that you could fit into the lock, but it wouldn't turn? There's a lot of things that are going to fit in your life. All right, Holy Spirit. But they're not going to unlock your life. There's a lot of things that'll fit in your mind, but won't unlock the power of your mind. There's a lot of things that'll fit in your heart, like relationships and people and things, but they're not going to unlock it. There's a lot of good wisdom out there that will try to fit its way into your life, but it'll never unlock your life. And while it may feel comfortable in you, it's not meant for you. And God has a key for you that will unlock. Oh, somebody give God some praise if you know what I'm preaching. Come on, give him a shout. I preached about the Holy Spirit most of my life because I got filled with the Holy Spirit when I was 6 years old and spoke in tongues. And I was taught all about the Holy Spirit. My father and my grandfather would quiz me about scriptures in the Bible about the Holy Spirit when I was 7. I preached my first message on the Holy Spirit when I was 13. And it wasn't until this week that God said, I'm more than just the power in your life. I am the presence in your life that will unlock mysteries in your life and reveal things in your life that nobody else can reveal. The Bible talks about in the New Testament that it mentions once that he's the comforter, he's power, he's the dunamis, he's this. But it mentions more times in the New Testament, all the way through it, that the reason the Holy Spirit is in your life is to unlock mysteries in your life. Even the Old Testament in the book of Psalms says you cannot have understanding unless the Holy One gives it to you. So quit trying to read the Bible when you haven't been baptized by fire. Because Can I go a little bit further? If water cleanses, we know it does that, right? And the Word of God does what the Scripture says. It says it pierces between soul and marrow, right? It pierces. Then what does fire do? Because fire is associated to the Holy Spirit. The fire divides. One of the scriptures I gave you says he came to go to houses of five and divide them into three and two. He came in to divide mother and daughter, father and son. Why? Because I remember another scripture where I hear separate and it says you're separated. You're a holy nation, a priesthood. I'm calling you out to be. The only way that I can make you different from everybody else who can't see insight and for what will be and unlock mysteries of what are, I have to baptize you by fire and separate you from people who think they're smart to people who know the future, who know what God holds, who knows the mysteries that God has inside you. And you have to be one of those people. Oh, give God a little bit of praise right there. The fire separates you. Gold, when it's heated up by fire, all of a sudden the stuff that's not meant to be comes to the surface and you get rid of it. When you get baptized by fire, all of a sudden you feel a separating. Don't get worried about it. Don't be fearful about it. Don't feel awkward about it. When the Holy Spirit separates you, it's so that you can feel something you've never felt. It's so that you can do something you've never done. It's so that you can understand things that are far beyond. How many know some scripture right now? A peace that surpasses your understanding. His ways are beyond your ways. His thoughts are beyond your thoughts. They're greater than you, but you cannot get to that point in the promise until you let him unlock your heart and let him search the mysteries of your heart. I could preach all night about this. But I want more than just preaching. I want you to do it. And more than Landon, God wants you to. God wants you to shut down your logic and get on the mind of Christ. God wants you to open up your heart and reveal. Nobody knows you like God. That's why the scripture says that he makes intercession and groanings for us. He makes it. Who better to make intercession for you than the one who knows you better than you? And he's going to speak things on your behalf that you can't even comprehend. But God can't be battling for you when he hasn't even gotten in you. And if God can get in you, then God can fight for you. Because if God be for me, who can be against me? But God must be in me. God must fill me. God must baptize me by fire and say, I need to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And you know what? A lot of Holy Ghost, Pentecostal, charismatic people say a first evidence of speaking in tongues. You know what? And I don't, whether they're right or wrong, I don't really care. But let me just tell you, there should be some evidence. I don't care what the evidence. Hey, you just start loving people more. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You have more self-discipline. You can prophesy. You can speak in tongues. You have a gift of discernment. Some of you women out there, you know that you feel a certain way about people before you really know them. And I'm just telling you the women, because somehow, and I've seen it over and over and over again, God gives women a very special gift of discerning attitudes, spirits, and people. And you know, you're like, oh, I don't trust them. You don't even know them. I don't have a good feeling. And you need to trust your gut. Do not second guess it. Because God's given you, there's evidence that he's working in you. And let his perfect work take place that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing. I want you to stand with me. We're not just going to preach about the Holy Spirit and then not pray it on us. Okay? So take a deep breath. Stretch it out right now because you're about to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And if you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit, you're going to get a fresh dose of something you've never touched before. And all you need to do is say, Lord, I want you to replace my thoughts for your thoughts. Lord, I want you to unlock my heart. Search me, O Lord. Search my heart, O Lord. Isn't that what David cried out to? Search my heart, O Lord. In fact, he says in Psalms, David says, those who let the Lord search them and fear the Lord, he will make his covenant known to you. And if God wants to reveal his plan to you, you got to let God in. You got to let him say, okay, Holy Spirit, I've only let you have half my heart, but I want to click. Oh, I want somebody to just begin to pray. Lord, click. I want to hear the click tonight. I want to hear an unlock tonight of something in my heart, something in my mind, and just begin to pray right now. Everybody here in person and online, I want you to begin to pray. Holy Spirit, I want you in my life. Holy Spirit, I invite you, because the Holy Spirit's not going to come where he's not invited. And the Holy Spirit wants to fill you. He wants to fill you tonight. He doesn't want you leaving here wondering about your future. He said, I want to show you your future. But the reasons you still are confused and lost and you have questions about your future is because the mystery has not been unlocked. Holy Spirit, fill us right now. And let the Holy Spirit unlock our heart, unlock our mind. Oh, saints, begin to pray. If you've been filled with the Holy Spirit, the Bible says that times of refreshing are going to come to those who repent. So if you repent right now of your sins, of your transgressions, of your iniquities, if you repent of what you know and didn't know you did, I want you to repent right now, because refreshing of the Holy Spirit is about to pour on your life. Holy Spirit, I don't need everybody else's voice. I need your voice. Dim the house lights. Turn the house lights down. Let's do like Elijah, and I want you to eliminate distractions. If you're at your house, turn the volume up of this message, and I want you to shut everything else out. Turn the lights out and just begin to just let the Holy Spirit speak to you. Holy Spirit, speak. Holy Spirit, speak. Oh, don't stop praying. See, the 120, they were up in the upper room for days and nights and days and nights. Because when you want to get filled and you want to get baptized, oh, your flesh is going to be tested. And you're going to have to put your flesh to the test and say, I'm not stopping till I get a pouring out of the Holy Spirit in my life. I'm not quitting until He pours it out on my heart and my mind. I am going to pray until I can't pray anymore. I'm going to believe till I can't, but I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep fighting. I'm going to keep worshiping. I'm going to keep my hands raised until my arms feel like they're going to fall off. I'm going to keep kneeling until my knees feel like they're getting blisters. Oh, somebody needs to get a pray through mentality and be able to say, God, I'm not leaving till I pray through. If you need this altar right now, that's what this altar is for. I want you to come down to this altar if you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit, refreshed by the Holy Spirit. And if you say, God, I need the altar to lay some things down, lay my mind down, lay my heart down, and let you search me, oh God. And Lord, I thank you, God, that there are some who fear you enough, cautiously and carefully consider who you are, that they might submit themselves. And as your word says in Romans, God, that we might become a living sacrifice so that we might know the acceptable and pleasing will of God. Oh, Holy Spirit, fill this place. Come on, saints, I want you to pray with me. If you know how to pray in tongues, you better be praying in tongues. If you feel the gift of prophecy speaking over you, oh, shandaramosiki rabasa, the power of the Holy Spirit is in this place. And the Father says right now, if you surrender, I've got a fresh outpouring. If you open up to me, my promises will open up to you. And Lord, right now we pray, pour it out, pour it out, pour it out. Unlock us, God. Unlock our potential. Unlock our mysteries. Unlock us, Lord. There's been some things in our life that have held us captive. But Lord, when your Spirit comes, mysteries are revealed. Why haven't my family turned to God? Oh, mystery unlocked. Oh, why haven't we overcome? Oh, mystery unlocked. Oh God, why haven't we won our city? Mystery unlocked. Lord, reveal mysteries to us right now. Give us the answers, God. Lord, we're here. We're called to be set apart and baptized by fire. And those who baptize by fire and by water can enter into the kingdom of God. And Lord, I thank you. We need a fresh baptism of the Holy Spirit. Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. If you need a healing in your body, I want you to either raise your hand or come down here or step out in some way, shape, or form. If you need a healing in your body, and I want to pray for you. God's given me a gift of healing, and I want to pray for you. If that's you, I want to make yourself known. I need to see you. I need to feel you. Lord, in Jesus' name, come on. I thank you for these people who need a gift. I need a healing in their body right now. And Lord, I pray that you would touch them. I pray that you would anoint them right now. God, Lord, that you are going to heal them in the name of Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that you are going to do a mighty and powerful work, and we are going to see miracle signs and wonders and a healing in our body. And Lord, in Jesus' name, I thank you, God, Lord, that you said in your word, if we come together and lay hands on one another, we will be healed. And I thank you that the promise of James chapter 5 is alive and right now. And Lord, I thank you, God. Keep praying, saints. Keep feeling what God is telling you. Keep hearing the voice. This is time where you just get to eliminate. And if the voice in this house is good for this house, it's good for your house. So let the voice of God resonate in your heart and in your mind. In Jesus' name, I thank you, God. I thank you, I thank you, I thank you, I thank you, Lord. You're going to give a whole new vision, whole new direction, God. There's something, a fresh outpouring in Jesus' mighty name. I thank you, a quickening is happening, God, Lord, in our hearts. And I thank you, a quickening is stirring up. I want somebody to put your hand on your stomach. And I want you to begin to pray. The Bible says that from the depths of who we are comes a wellspring of life. And I want you to say, God, stir up the gift. Come on, just begin to pray. God, stir up the gift. Stir up the gift of the Holy Spirit in me. God, stir up the gift, because with the gift, I can then become a blessing to other people. With the gift of the Holy Spirit, I can then help change the world. I can then have the power, like Peter did, to stand on the day of Pentecost and have all boldness and courage and speak who Jesus is. Holy Spirit, oh, while you're praying and interceding, can I speak something that the Holy Spirit is telling me right now? Do you remember the story of the woman with the issue of blood? The woman with the issue of blood, a lot of people like to teach how Jesus, or how she touched Jesus. Did she touch Jesus? No. What did she touch? The hem. The hem of his garment. I'm preaching to somebody who's experiencing Jesus right now. the garment was just touching Jesus. And because the garment was touching Jesus, it could touch and heal her. If you get touched by God, when other people touch you, they can get healed because you have experienced and touched Jesus. You're not seeing the healing and the breakthrough you want because you haven't touched him. When you touch him, then you can touch other people in your workplace, in your family, and everywhere you go. And people are going to say, what's different about you? How did that happen to me? Why do I feel different around you? Why does something stir within me? Because you could say, oh, I touched Jesus today. I touched Jesus. I touched Jesus. I touched Jesus. I touched Jesus. When Jesus touches you, you can touch the world. But until we cannot touch the world until we first touch him. And we're called to touch him. We're called to say, God, I need a touch from you. And especially right now in this touchless society we live in. Did you know that was one of the problems that, see, what happened in the Garden of Eden was it went from a very touching, embracing moment to all of a sudden hiding and distancing and no touching. And God says, no, 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 no. Where are you, Adam? Where are you? I love you. And he pulled him back in and he covered him and he said, hey, it's all good. Why? Because he says, no. And then he did. He moved heaven and hell to send his son to the earth. Why? So that he could touch your life. So that you don't have to live this life of like, oh, I wonder who God is. I wonder where he's at. I wonder if there even is a God. And Jesus came to this earth so that you didn't have to wander through life with all question marks, but so that the Holy Spirit could come upon you and reveal mysteries and give answers to your life and say, I came and showed up just for you on a Wednesday night to pour out my spirit. Oh, give God some praise, church. Let's give God some praise on credit. Let the Holy Spirit fall in this place. From the front to the back, the right to the left, let the Holy Spirit fall as worship proceeds. And I thank you, Lord. Oh, somebody needs a miracle. Somebody needs a miracle. Somebody needs a miracle. And I need somebody who's desiring a miracle to fight through your weakness long enough to let the Holy Spirit be your strength. Holy Spirit, oh, we're pressing in tonight. And for those of you who are sitting there saying, I don't feel it yet, tell your flesh, I don't care what you feel. For those who don't feel it yet, tell your flesh, I don't care what you feel. My flesh will not dictate my praise. My flesh will not dictate my prayer. My flesh will not dictate my faith. My flesh will not tell me, no, no, no. I cast down every, your imagination, your thoughts, and your feelings are have what led you to the destructive path you've been on. But now, because of the Holy Spirit in your life, you have a new path. You have a healed path, a redemptive path. You have a free path. Because now you get to tell your flesh, this is how it's going to be. Because it's either your spirit that rules you or your flesh. And that's why we need a refreshing of the Holy Spirit just to push through a little bit and say, man, I'm not, no, 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 no. I'm going to fight through this. We call it fight through praise. Paul and Silas were in a prison. Didn't look good, didn't feel good, but they began to sing. And as they began to sing, all of a sudden shackles came off, walls came down. People got saved and healed and delivered. Why? Because somebody decided to praise and worship and fight their way through it with praise. That's how we do. And I like taking it. Is it all right that we take a little time? Because well, we just need to fight through some things. Because think about it. If all the voices are the sum total of your, how long is it going to take to get rid of those voices? That's why a pastor, that's why, let me, can I, that's why churches who have the 20-minute one and done aren't going to get it done. It's because we got to take some time in the Holy Spirit and say, we need to saturate a little bit. I need to preach a little bit longer because the voice that's been ruling your mind and your heart is still speaking while the Holy Spirit's trying to talk to you. And you have seared your conscience and you cannot feel or hear or see anything. And the pastor and the preacher and the brothers and sisters and saints of faith have to fight through it all just to get to a place where you hear a whisper. Because he speaks in a still small voice. And he says, I know it's been a while, but I'm going to get through. And I'm going to get louder. And I'm going to be the most dominating voice in your life. And then when you've got questions, you'll know where the answer came from. You won't have to wonder, are you headed the right direction? You'll know you're headed the right. You won't have a lot of mysteries in your life. You'll have a lot of answers in your life. This world is begging for answers, and there's only one group of people who have them. It's the Spirit-filled, Bible-believing, grace-covered people of God who have an answer and can speak with faith and power and love and truth and say, be free, because where the Son sets free, or whom the Son sets free, is free indeed. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. But what we can't get it done. Oh, well, the service went longer today. I had lunch. I had dinner plans. If you're looking at your watch while service is happening, you're always going to be the person left with question marks instead of answers. If you become the person who says, I can't wait to stay a little longer, you'll become the person with answers. And like we talked about just a little while ago, people with answers, right, get paid a lot of money. That's what we talked about on Sunday, because people pay good money for answers, problem solvers, solution people. And we got a lot of world with a lot of hurt and a lot of pain, a lot of questions, a lot of confusion. Come on. How many feel like there's a lot of manipulative game going on out there in the world? Am I the only one who feels like there's a lot of unanswered questions and there's some things that aren't being told and aren't being said and aren't being spoken, aren't being truthful about? The Bible says that I will reveal all mysteries to you when the Holy Spirit comes in. I'll tell you what you need to know. Because if you've lived long enough, you know one truth is this, is that some things you don't need to know. Because they're not important. But there are some things that you do need to know. And if you're left in the dark long enough, you'll feel like the dark is where you're meant to be. Stop living in the dark. Start living in the light. Can I pray with you before we close? In fact, no. Let's pray together before we close. Lord, in Jesus' name, come on, saints, I want to hear you pray with me. Lord, I pray that we're going to become an answer. We're going to take the key of our life, which is the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the living God, and we are going to unlock our heart. We're going to unlock our mind with it. And God, we are going to see a greater level of, Lord, solutions and mysteries being revealed to us that were once hidden from us. And Lord, I thank you. Right now, somebody's being filled with the Holy Spirit, and they're fighting through it. They don't get it. Their mind is trying to stop them right now. And I'm speaking faith that something clicks and unlocks and they just say, you know what, God, I receive it. You know what, God, I believe it. You know what, God, unlock me, search me, make my mind your mind. I'm tired of my thoughts. And those people who are going to be filled with the Holy Spirit are going to be set free like never before. And you're going to start seeing the gifts of the Spirit work through you. Oh, somebody's beginning to prophesy. When you go to work tomorrow, you're going to prophesy over your employees. When you go into your next season of your life, God's going to say, I'm going to give you the discernment to walk through that season. And Lord, we thank you, God, Lord, that somebody's going to get the gift of tongues right now. And you just begin to speak it. It's a new heavenly language. Holy Spirit, speak. Holy Spirit, speak. Oh, yeah, you think it's just gibberish. Go ahead and let that murmur. Go ahead and let that mumbling. Go ahead and take place. Oh, some of you who haven't spoken tongues in a long time, you just need to begin to use those two words you do know. That heavenly language. Lord, in Jesus' name, I thank you, God. Lord, that there is freedom here. There is liberty here. There is power here. And Lord, where your Spirit is, there is truth. And somebody heard me speak in tongues, but you heard English. Oh, I know somebody heard it right. The Holy Spirit just told me. He said, I spoke a word and somebody just heard it for themselves. It's okay. You don't have to speak it out loud. There's an interpretation in your heart. And I think it was personally just for you. May not be for everybody. And Lord, I thank you, God, Lord, that you're going to speak and you're going to reveal. And there's some new fruit that's going to come from this night. Oh, yeah, some new fruit that's going to come from this night, because there's a root issue that you've begun to deal with. So the old fruit's going to go away and the new fruit's going to come. And I thank you, God, Lord, that new fruit is coming. New fruit is coming. In Jesus, Jesus, Jesus' name. Unlock it. Unlock it. Click, 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 click. All this week, I want you to hear that. Wherever you go, all of a sudden, something clicks. Maybe some of you who it's the flesh is keeping you from something. It's going to be a couple days from now, and all of a sudden, you're going to hear a click in your heart, and God's going to start unlocking some things in you. Holy Spirit, we thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, we receive all that you have poured out and given to us and all that you will do in the days and moments to come. And all those who had the faith to receive it and believe it, give God some praise right now. Yeah, amen, 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 amen. Oh, God, we lift up a shout of praise. Amen. We're going to see God move. I'm feeling it. I love it. I feel like we're back to church again. This is great. And I can't wait to keep moving forward. Don't miss out. Plug in for what's coming on through the week, coming up. Stay connected, right? I want to speak this declaration together, and I want to speak it boldly. Some of you, listen, I want to teach our core. This is our core, right? On Sundays, I'm like, let's repeat this together. I am a praise builder. Okay? Not that loudness is everything, but man, if you can't say a declaration of love and blessing and best over your life at church with all passion and boldness, you're going to have a tough time everywhere else. So might as well build the courage here. Amen? So when we speak this, let's declare this. I am a bridge builder. This is my season of favor. I am blessed to live my best. I will choose to love him first. I will worship fully, love deeply, and my community will thrive because I am praying for it. I am a carrier of peace. I will represent God's gentleness to myself and others. I will live out his gospel. I am blessed to live my best because I am a bridge builder. Amen. God bless you, Bridge.
We're so glad you joined us today. If you made a spiritual decision, whether that was dedicating your life to Christ or rededicating your life to Christ, send us an email at info@weirbridge.church and let us know you made that spiritual decision.
Also, if you're joining our Bridge Church family online for the first time, we have a very special gift for you. Send us an email at info@weirbridge.church to share some information on where we can send you that gift.
We're so glad you joined us today, and we can't wait to see you soon. Be sure to stay connected, because we're so much better
together.